second part of the video today is a response to a question I had about measurement microphones. Now, what they meant was those microphones that you sometimes see live sound people using when they want to have a look at what the PA system in the room is doing. So the idea is you squirt some pink noise into your system, so you've got low right the way through to high coming out as pink noise. You then stick one of these measurement microphones out, and they've got quite a flat frequency response. And when you look at the displays, you can see if you've got any peaks or troughs. So if something is sucking out sort of 4K and making the sound a bit odd, it's visually very easy to spot, and then you can do something about it. Equally, if it'll tell you how well the subs are doing their job. Typically with live sound stuff, if you play music, you know, it sounds okay. And you think, yeah, I'm playing this track, I know the track very well, and everything sounds normal. The snag is, of course, if one of the subs has perhaps got disconnected, you might not have noticed. In my particular case, the measurement mic came out simply because somebody said, is the right channel meant to be down a bit? And I sort of listened with one sort of ear slightly sort of cocked and thought, do you know, something is odd, but I'm not sure if it's the right channel down a bit. So get a microphone, plonk it on the stand, play the noise, and then see what's missing. And in my particular case, it was one of the subs. There were three subs on one side and two on the other. Someone had kicked a cable and the connector had come out. Nothing very exciting. But then the following question. Well, if these measurement microphones have got such a great flat frequency response, why don't we use them to record audio? I suppose that's actually a pretty valid question. Why don't we use them to record audio? Well, I suppose the problem really is that we choose most microphones because they're actually flattering. So we, you know, if you go and spend loads and loads of money on a Neumann U87, you've bought the thing because it's sort of not flat. It enhances little bits here, it sort of removes a little bit there and makes a voice sound warm and nice. If you replace it with something like an SM57, you know you're going to get that little presence peak that helps things pop through. So normal microphones have got sort of character, and measurement microphones haven't. So I thought we'd do a little experiment. So what I've done is I've stuck up an omnidirectional Shure SM63, which is an Omni mic. It's quite a bright sounding mic. If you want an Omni that's like quite nice, but you can also use it if you wanted to as a handheld. It's actually one of the ones that was very popular when Karen Carpenter was singing live. For some very strange reason, Karen Carpenter quite often sang into omnidirectional microphones live on stage. I'm guessing it's so that the distance between her mouth and the microphone didn't do the proximity effect thing and change the quality of her voice. And I guess for her it was particularly important. So they actually used omnidirectional microphones, which is odd, but they did it. So I've got an SM63 as a sort of musical Omni, so it isn't flat. And if you want to know, you can always look up the specs on the 63. But it isn't flat, it's got little peaks and troughs. Next to it is a Behringer 8000 measurement mic. So, two Omni microphones, both sort of on paper, sort of similar in terms of what they do. There we go. We're on the SM7B now, switching across to the Omni, okay? Now we're on the Shure SM63. So that's our Omni, and it doesn't really matter if I go in close or come away. It's just an Omni. The tone stays the same no matter where I'm going to be around it. And I quite like these microphones. They're quite truthful. They reveal quite a lot. They've got reasonable amount up top. Oddly, they're not particularly sensitive. So we could have a bit of a noise problem with the 63 because it's designed for handheld use. So gain-wise, it's up fairly high. So if there is any noise, I do apologise about that. But it's, you know, I chose it and I'm lumbered with its noise content. Obviously, it's designed to pick up fairly close too. But tonally, this is the SM63. How about now then if we switch across to the measurement mic? Okay, we're on the measurement mic now. So the Behringer measurement mic is designed simply to do the task of giving as flat a frequency response as it possibly can, so you can make critical decisions about peaks and troughs when you're looking at the pink noise response. So that sort of works, I think, as a microphone to do that. It does the job pretty well. I mean, there are quite a few. I mean, there's the very expensive Earthworks. There's two or three others. They've all got the same basic shape too, with a very narrow front designed to keep the microphone as clear as possible from obstacles, from reflections, things like that. What we don't want is the mic body itself to sort of play a role in what the microphone hears. So the idea of that little tube gets the mic element as far away from the mic as it possibly can, as slim as it can. So you've got the electronics in the chunky bit at the back, but the actual bit that lets the audio into the capsule is right at the front. So that's a sensible idea. We don't have that facility on the Shure SM63. So flipping between the two microphones, there is a sort of difference in the colour of the microphones. The Behringer, I see no real reason for not using it. I mean, it's, you know, it does the job pretty well. I suppose what we could do is try and use it with an instrument. Bear with me, I shall grab a guitar. For the demo, I'm not going to move the mics because they're omnis, so they don't actually need to be pointed, and they're a little bit further than would be ideal recording a guitar, but really what we're trying to do is hear the difference in the tone that we're capturing rather than any sort of quality thing. So that's what we're going to do next then, have a listen to this guitar. I'm not really expecting the Behringer to be particularly nice sounding on this guitar because it's a fairly bright brush guitar, and I suspect it would benefit by some sort of dips and troughs in the frequency response because it's not a wonderful guitar. But as a measurement mic, it's going to capture exactly what it hears, so it could be quite interesting. Can you get away with it? Well, yeah, you probably can. I mean, they're just a bit of a boring microphone. They don't really have a flavour. There's no real sort of colour there. But I guess with some EQ and the usual effects, I don't see any real reason why you can't. I mean, the real differences are, should you use an omnidirectional mic to record a guitar? And probably the answer is no, because the directivity is what gives you the ability to focus on the fingerboard end or the sound hole or where your fingers are. So although it's perfectly possible to use an Omni mic, would you really want to? Between the Behringer and the Shure, two perfectly okay Omni microphones, is that difference in tonal quality worth talking about? My vote's sort of firmly sitting on the fence here. I don't really have an opinion. I won't use that Behringer mic. It's going to go back in its box and I'll just use it for the normal things. Pink noise. But equally, I don't usually use the Shure SM63 either. And I guess I could. I just don't. There we go. An open-ended video. What do you think? So now at least you know what a measurement microphone does sound like if you try and use it to record voices or instruments. And I suspect you probably won't. Anyway, see you on the next video. Have a good week. Look after yourselves. Take care.